After a torrid performance year in 2013 for risk assets, in 2014, questions immediately presented themselves in the form of emerging markets and also questions around the sustainability of growth in the United States and the weather impact. However, as we moved through the quarter, risk asset flows did return, and by the time the quarter had concluded, performance across most assets was positive, if modest. Taking a look at equity markets, returns were a little over 1% worldwide, nearly 2% in the United States. Credit markets continued to do very, very well, up between 2.5% to 3%, and in treasuries in the United States, yields did fall, leading to positive returns there also. Now, the questions still remain, and socio-political risks are very, very difficult to forecast as it pertains to some of the headlines in emerging markets. But what we can do is take a look at the fundamental growth picture, and that remains largely unchanged, with an expectation of global growth a little over 3% this year. And also, as we've talked about, we do expect the gap between emerging markets and developed markets to continue to narrow, with emerging markets growth a little weaker this year than last, and developed markets growth double from what we saw in 2013. I want to focus on two countries, however, and they're the world's two largest economies, China and the United States, both getting their share of headlines this quarter. In China, it's important, we think, to take a step back and remember that they're trying to alter the very nature of their economy from one that's savings and investment-led to one that's consumption-led, and that's going to create volatility. One area of such volatility in the first quarter were some defaults in trust products, and that immediately brings to mind shadow banking, and that makes us think of the United States in 2007. And while that was a very large number, you have to go a long way down the list to get to China, and that's a much smaller percentage. And let's not forget that China is backed by the largest level of reserves in modern history. I'd also like to look at the bigger picture in the United States. Growth there for some time has been driven by relative strength in the private sector and weakness and negative performance in the public sector. As we move forward in 2014, we expect private sector strength to continue, led by consumption, and the public sector headwinds to fall away and generate modestly positive performance. One way to look at sustainability of growth is through the jobs and income picture, and in this case, one way to capture that is taxes. Notice that tax collections continued to move strongly through the weaker winter and even reach new highs. And another thing that's important relates to employment. Most folks don't know this, but in the first quarter, household employment had a historic quarter, generating gains of over 1.15 million jobs, the largest in over 25 years. However, the Federal Reserve also mentioned in this quarter that they're going to move away from pure unemployment or quantity of labor and look at the quality of labor. And so that's why we're showing you this, the U6, the underemployment rate, which captures discouraged workers or those employed part-time for economic reasons. But even there, the trend is of an improvement as the underemployment rate continues to fall. And so as we move forward, we expect that to obviously be supportive of U.S. growth. Now, what does it mean for the federal funds rate? Well, in the past, we've used the Taylor rule to give you a sense of that path, and it was low and slow. However, as the Federal Reserve changes its emphasis, so do we, away from the Taylor rule and the unemployment rate to one that's market-based and the market's assessment of the federal funds path. But again, it's still low and slow, generating a normalization of yields over the next several years and modestly positive bond returns. However, as we've said before, we also don't expect that you should only own U.S. Treasuries. We want you to be balanced. Own interest rate sensitive securities on one hand and credit sensitive securities on the other hand. In the interest rate space, be efficient. Own global fixed income. Own municipals if you're in the United States. That's a better way to take that risk, we believe. On the credit side, a moderate improving world economy and good balance sheets in the United States tell you you should probably own some U.S. credit, and we agree. But we also think you should be very selective. This is not the time to reach for yield. In fact, so many investors are chasing income that it's creating very crowded trades, like these in triple C rated bonds. Ordinarily, you can see what your regular compensation should be for owning a triple C rated bonds. Double B's, today's spreads are about average. Single B, not that far below, but triple C is way below. And that's paired with something else somewhat jarring. Over the last 25 years, premium priced triple C bonds have basically never happened. But we can see today they are trading at a premium. And lurking in the backdrop somewhere is the reality that on five-year cumulative timeframes, the default rate in triple C rated bonds is about 50%. Now, our economic view doesn't support big defaults this year, but we certainly believe you should be compensated for the risk that you take. And that's why we focus today more on quality of income than quantity of income. So going forward, first, there's always going to be challenges in the world, like we're seeing in emerging markets and headlines today. So let's take a step back and look at the longer-term view that we see of improving moderate global growth, low levels of global inflation, continued accommodative policy for some time, leading to a low and slow path of rates, steeper curves in certain developed markets that we can take advantage of, and as always, the time-trusted advice that we are going to give you now and going forward. Be balanced, be selective, and don't reach for yield. Play proper defense, move through the rate rising cycle, and remain invested. Thanks again for joining. I will see you next quarter.